Well, good morning, Selby Pastoral Charge, and welcome to this time of worship for July 19th, 2020. The psalmist sings, "You will make known to me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. In your right hand there are pleasures forever." As followers of Jesus, we believe that life at its best is lived following the path of God. And that's what we're talking about today, a profoundly countercultural way of being human. The sun comes up, and it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass, whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Let's sing together. Well, today, we're at the historic Lonsdale Church, built in 1868. This was yet another Methodist church, part of that Methodist explosion that occurred throughout this region in the mid-19th century. In 1906, the Presbyterian Church took over this building, and worship continued in this place until 1967. Today, this church opens once a year for a memorial service in honor of those who rest in the beautiful cemetery that is still in operation here. But this beautifully maintained church stands as a monument to a simple way of life and the faithfulness of our ancestors. This church has no electricity, lights, washrooms, or other amenities that we take for granted. It's heated by a couple of old wood stoves in the back of the church and illuminated by coal oil lamps. But even as this is a simple place, the legacy of the ministry that went on in this place continues to be known even today. And so as we begin our worship this morning, let's join our hearts together in prayer. O Lord, in these hot summer days, it is good to take time to consider what it is that makes our lives meaningful and good in your sight. Come and be present with us this morning. Encourage us and challenge us to participate in your alternative kingdom in the midst of our broken old world. Amen. Well, as always this morning, we are in for a musical treat. Jennifer Tomlinson, Lois Tomlinson's daughter, who grew up in Selby and happens to be home visiting her mom, has a special musical offering for us today. Here's Jennifer.
I will sweep away your transgressions like a cloud, and you return to me. I will heal you, for I love you. If you say to me, Father, I am blind, if you say to me, I can't see, I will be your light, I'll restore your sight, place all of your darkness in me. Sweep away your transgressions like a cloud, and your sins will be to me like a mist dissolved. So return to me, I will heal you, for I love you. If you say to me, I'm in prison, Lord, imprisoned by my fear, then I'll come to you, I will comfort you, let me wipe away your tears. Sweep away your transgressions like a cloud, and your sins will be to me like a mist dissolved. So return to me, I will heal you, for I love you. If you say to me, I am lame and poor, I need to be healed and set free. I have sinned, O Lord, I am sorry, Lord, I need you to live in me. I will sweep away your transgressions like a cloud, and your sins will be to me like a mist dissolved. So return to me, I will heal you, for I love you. So return to me, I will heal you, for I love you.
Hey, I have a really important question for our young people this morning. Is this a 6 or is it a 9? What do you think? Well, I guess it could be both. It depends on how we hold the paper, right? And I guess it's really not that important anyway. Well, today, Emmett is going to read a passage from Jeremiah where two people disagree over an important truth about God. Jeremiah says God can be anywhere and love anyone God wants to. Pasher the priest says God can only be experienced in one place, in the temple in Jerusalem. It didn't go well. We'll hear about that in a few minutes. But why was this such an important argument? Why was Jeremiah willing to be treated so badly to stand up for what he believed to be true? Well, someone once gave me this sign. It says, I don't know what tomorrow holds, but I know who holds tomorrow. That's really good news. If God is holding today and tomorrow, then I don't really need to worry about things I can't control, right? I can give that stuff to God and know that he will look after me. And you know what? This truth has made all the difference for people who follow Jesus. Knowing that God is not confined to any one place or time means that we can live with confidence today. It means we can carry our candle and run to the darkness, seek out the hopeless, confused, and torn, because God is already there. It means you can take your candle and go light your world. That's a song we sing in Cornerstone on Wednesday nights, and it's got beautiful lyrics. Let's sing it together. Well, today we are continuing in our summer sermon series, working our way through the book of Jeremiah. And today, Jeremiah, having delivered God's word last week, is now receives the retaliation for it. And Pashur, the priest of the temple, has something to say about it. So here is the word of God delivered to us through the voice of Emmett Wyonzik.
Today I'm reading from Jeremiah chapter 20, verses 1 to 3. The priest Pashur, son of Imer, was the senior priest in God's temple. He heard Jeremiah preach his sermon. He whipped Jeremiah the prophet and put him in the stocks at the upper Benjamin gate of God's temple. The next day, Pashur came and let him go. Jeremiah told him, God has a new name for you, not Pashur, but danger everywhere, because God says you are danger to yourself and everyone around you. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, thanks, Emmett. Let's pray together. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come so that we might hear what you have for us today. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I wonder if this sermon series is what you expected. I mean, when someone says they're going to talk about living life at its best, you might imagine that you're going to get a lot of those lists. You know the kind, 10 ways to find happiness, or 5 steps to financial wellness, or 7 ways to reduce stress, those kind of lists. But that's just not what we get when we read the Bible. We don't find simple recipes to improve the life you already have. Jesus doesn't call his disciples to join him once a week for a one-hour session on self-improvement techniques. He doesn't meet them on the seashore to teach them a new meditation practice. No, he calls them to leave everything behind and to follow him. Jesus' essential message isn't to be nicer people or to make the world a better place. He didn't come so that we could better achieve our personal life goals or so that we could accomplish our wildest dreams. No, Jesus came to show us that reality is not what it always seems. He lived and died to make a whole new way of being possible, a way that only makes sense in light of God's amazing grace and sacrificial love. But that's the thing. On the surface and from the outside, what Jesus is all about can seem downright confusing. It so easily gets distorted or contorted to affirm our particular cultural outlook. But in fact, what Jesus was doing was challenging the established worldview. He's messing with us, in a good way, to open us to the way that God sees the world. It didn't always go well. People didn't always appreciate being messed with. It ended on a cross. Well, this morning we have seen Jeremiah challenge the worldview of Pashur, the priest of the temple. It didn't go well either. Pashur had Jeremiah whipped and thrown into the stocks for what he was saying. Probably because Jeremiah was declaring God's message that God couldn't be confined by any human limitations that we might want to impose upon him. Remember, the temple was controlled by the priestly class. As I said a few weeks ago, there was a whole economy built around the temple, and it all hung on the fact that it was the one place on earth where God lived. With Jeremiah out there saying that God was free to come and go as he pleased, he was bound to ruffle some feathers. A message like that needs to be contained. People need to have confidence in the religious system. Our way of life depends on it, they might have said. Eugene Peterson, when he was first ordained, was sent to be an assistant pastor in a large, affluent suburban church. I was glad to be part of such an obviously winning organization, he recalled. After I'd been there a short time, a few people asked me to lead them in a Bible study. Of course, I said, there was nothing I would rather do. We met on Monday evenings. There weren't many, 8 or 9 men and women, but even so, there was the 2 or 3 that Jesus defined as a quorum. After a few weeks, the senior pastor, my boss, asked me what I was doing with my Monday evenings. I told him. He asked me how many people were there. I told him. He told me I'd have to stop. Why? I asked. It's not cost-effective. That's too few people to spend your time on. I was then introduced to the principles of successful church administration. This church was known for its music, big choirs, professionally executed. The sermons were all 7 minutes long. There were some very impressive people on the membership list. Crowds are important, I was taught. Individuals are expendable. The positive must always be accented. The negative must be suppressed. Don't expect too much of people. Your job is to make them feel good about themselves and about the church. Don't talk too much about abstractions like God and sin. Deal with practical issues. It soon became apparent that I had been hired to help run a church and to do so efficiently as possible, to be a cheerleader to this dynamic organization. But I thought I was there to make disciples for Jesus. I got out of there as quickly as I could. You see, there is often a dominant narrative being told. It's how we order our society. There are sets of truths that everyone must buy into, and then we go about ordering our lives according to those truths. But sometimes these truths can send us, well, in troubling directions. And that's the problem for followers of Jesus. We've got a different story making sense of our lives. It will, at times, chafe against the dominant narrative. I recently watched a documentary on Netflix about Johnny Cash. It was all about Nixon's invitation for Johnny Cash to play at the White House. At the time, the nation was increasingly embroiled in the controversy over civil rights and the Vietnam War. People were protesting, and young people were disenfranchised. Nixon knew that something had to be done, and he needed to reach out to what he called the silent majority by appealing to middle America. Nixon himself was no particular fan of country music. He preferred classical himself. But he could see that if he was going to appeal to the vast majority of Americans, he would need to shift his image. To this end, Nixon was the first American president to visit the Grand Ole Opry. Johnny Cash was conflicted. At the time, Cash had a great respect for the president and a love for his country. He even used his weekly TV show to call people to stand behind the President of the United States in his quest for a just and lasting peace. The White House was listening. And in 1970, Nixon wrote Johnny Cash a letter inviting him to play at a very special banquet at the White House. He specifically requested two songs, Welfare Cadillac and Okie from Muskogee, two widely known redneck songs, both considered lightning rods for the anti-hippie movement. What the documentary, of course, skims over is the role Johnny Cash's faith played in his life. Cash, nicknamed the Man in Black, explains the meaning of that name in a song, singing, "I wear the black for those who never read or listened to the words that Jesus said about the road to happiness through love and charity." For Cash, this trademark black meant death to self. It meant the cross of Christ. It was political and spiritual. It was Cash's alternative narrative around which he tried to order his life. But as time went on, and as the White House performance date drew closer, Cash had his eyes opened. He went to Vietnam to perform for the troops, as celebrities often did in those days. As he and his wife lay in their army tent trying to sleep that night, they listened to the wounded being brought back in helicopters and the distant din of American bombs pounding bamboo villages. Johnny Cash was beginning to question the dominant narrative. His views were changing. He told his pastor, "I'm in a search mode right now. I'm troubled by what I saw over there." He met with Billy Graham. Billy and Ruth had been longtime friends, and they had supper one night. Billy told Johnny that he had a voice that speaks to the youth, and that he hoped he would use this gift to speak to young people today. At the same time, his son was born. He was inspired to write a new song about young people and the future. On the night of his White House performance, people still wondered what Johnny Cash was going to play. When Nixon personally introduced him, he said, "One thing I've learned is never tell Johnny Cash what to sing." He took his seat and waited to hear what the artist was going to perform. He didn't play the two songs that he'd been asked to sing by the president. Instead, he did a variety of his own repertoire. He began to introduce his final song, saying, "We took our show over to Long Ben Air Force Base near Saigon to do some shows for the men over there. Some say that makes me a hawk. You went to Vietnam. No. But after you watch the wounded come in helicopters, if you're a dove, you might come away a dove with claws." And then, after a long, awkward pause, he began to sing. "A little boy of three sitting on the floor looks up and says, 'Daddy, what's war? Son, that's where people fight and die.' The little boy of three says, 'Daddy, why?' A young man of 17 in Sunday school being taught the golden rule. And by the time another year has gone around, it may be his turn to lay his life down. Can you blame the voice of youth for asking, 'What's truth?'" The most powerful man in the United States, the man responsible for sending America's young to fight and die, was there and heard that message that night. There are different ways of understanding the world. Some see the world as an opportunity to get what you want. Others see the world as God's, perfectly made to be enjoyed by his children. But the thing is, the world starts to make a whole lot more sense when we see it as God does. Some people don't want to hear what God has to say. They're challenged by Christ's message of costly love, unconditional forgiveness, of purposeful living. The inconvenient reality of our demanding God, will always send us in directions counter to the world's. And that's what should make followers of Jesus just a little different. We don't listen to what will be popular. We listen to the Word of God to test every other narrative, to discover all meaning and worth by examining life in relation to Jesus Christ. It was Jeremiah's job as God's prophet to challenge the culture and to speak an alternative truth in a culture that loves a good bargain and admires those who find shortcuts. This will seem kind of strange. But if we're going to find life at its best, we're going to have to learn to do it God's way. Thanks be to God. Amen. Well, now it's time to bless our offering. We are so grateful for your generosity in this time. If you'd like to send your offering this morning, you can do so by mail, e-transfer, or by joining our online banking option called PAR. The mail addresses and email address are on your screen now. And so these are the gifts of our hands and the love of our hearts. May they be a blessing to this community and the wider world. In Jesus' name, amen. And so now it's time for our prayer of the people. We pray as we usually do, giving thanks to God, lifting up our concerns for our community and the wider world, and then praying for the individuals who we know need God's work in their lives. After each section, I will pause so that you can lift up your own thoughts to God. So let us join together in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this summer season. A season where we prepare to head on vacation and enjoy the bounty and the beauty of this time. Lord, we each have our own gratitudes, the foods that we enjoy in summer, the family gatherings that we are enjoying, the beginning of opening up our economy and the opening up of our world once again, and all of the blessings that come with that. And so in the silence of this moment, we list those things that we are just so grateful for. And Lord, we know that your world continues to be broken in so many ways. We pray that your story, your narrative, will be the healing force at work within this world. We pray for the whole COVID-19 situation. We pray for those places where there are still hot spots and the virus is spreading. We pray for those who are trying to get back to work. We pray for our economy, Lord. We pray that that things will get moving again and people will again have financial security. And so, Lord, in this time, we come before you with our many concerns, not only COVID-19, but all of those things that weigh on our hearts and minds. And Lord, there are so many individuals who weigh on our hearts today. It's hard to connect with those people other than a phone call, but we wish we could do more. And so for those who are grieving, for those who are recovering from health challenges, for those who are just beginning to face those difficult stages in life, for those who are facing broken pasts and hurts that continue to affect them today. And so in the silence of this moment, we lift those names to you that we know are in need of your healing mercies today. And we pray together as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, as our service draws to a close, it's time for our closing hymn, I Don't Know About Tomorrow. Here's Vince and Doug.
I don't know about tomorrow. I don't fall.
Well, later on today, I'll be heading away on vacation for 2 Sundays. It's our normal routine to close for 2 weeks during the summer months, which gives everyone a break and an opportunity to visit our neighboring churches, which I encourage you to do, even during this time of pandemic. And so as we head out into this summer break this week, receive this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Go now in peace. Amen.